Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, wherever you are in the world. So here I am in the Arctic Circle, and I'd like to welcome you back to this snowy environment for the Global Schools Festival. I hope you've enjoyed all of the sessions so far, yesterday and earlier today, and there are more to come and more tomorrow. So I'm really happy to be with you here virtually today. I'm David Valente, and I'm coordinator of the IETEFL Young Learners and Teenagers Special Interest Group. Today I'm focusing on using drama in primary English language teaching to give children more choice about the activities and the language they use actually in their lessons, and more voice, more opportunities to personalize and use English in a meaningful, engaging, and creative way. Today, I'm linking the use of drama with the use of story. Now, why story in particular? I'd like to start by sharing this quote from Jonathan Gottesloh, which really highlights the powerful creative potential of stories. He says, "We are, as a species, addicted to story. Even when the body goes to sleep, the mind stays up all night telling itself stories." So stories spark the imagination. They create vivid images in the minds of children. They help children to dream. And we can capture that and enhance that in our English lessons through the use of drama. So I'm linking stories and drama today. Carol Reed also does that in her article on scaffolding. And she unpacks, she shares the principles behind using drama and story and what make them so suitable for primary English language teaching. First of all, then, the playful capacity of both story and drama. We can help children use the story scripts and change elements of the story script to come up with whole new scripts. And they can be very creative and very playful when they change the characters, they change what the characters do, they change what the characters like. So lots of capacity by using the script from the story and then adapting it through drama. They suspend norms. So the norms of time, the norms of place. So we could be 1 minute in the Arctic Circle with the snow, but in the next minute, we could be on another planet. We could be on a tropical island. If only I were on a tropical island right now. So they also have amazing potential, carefully selected stories to highlight significant issues in ways, important issues, big issues, challenging issues even, but in ways that are accessible and digestible by children. So for example, if you have a story of an alien and an alien arrives on planet Earth but can't speak the language and it's difficult for the alien to communicate. So this can be all a child-friendly story, but actually there's a deeper significance around, for example, being a child refugee, going to another country, struggling to learn the language. And even for all children learning English, the struggles that they have learning a new language. So these issues can be safely distanced enough, but still encourage them to empathize and understand other people's experiences at a deeper level. Stories and drama, Carol Reed goes on to say, are both social and communal. So they're shared experiences, especially if we're using read alouds. So when the teacher shares the story, particularly through picture books, with the children, and more what we've seen during these lockdown periods are picture book creators, so authors and illustrators, or people who do both, author illustrators, sharing their own stories through YouTube. So they read them aloud. And these are wonderful vehicles for bringing that social element and making story a shared experience. And then reenacting these, acting out the dialogues in pairs and groups, makes story and drama a real communal experience. They offer opportunities in primary English teaching for us to explore with the children conventions and conventional behaviour. So, for example, conventionally, we might say stereotypically, a lion is meant to be fierce. But in a story, maybe there's a lion who likes poetry and daydreaming. So really questioning and challenging the conventions, which again, safely enables children who are different, children who are diverse, children who perhaps don't conform to convention, to feel more comfortable and to recognize that there are other children through the character of the story around the world and also in their own context, who don't conform to convention, and that's okay. Story and drama provide excellent scaffolding, for children to speak with support, so starting from the story script, acting out the dialogue, and then gradually removing that scaffolding, giving children more choice, choice of the vocabulary they're using, choice of the characters, choice of the feelings and emotions of the characters through drama, provides robust and child-friendly scaffolding for them to experiment with language and to try out new vocabulary and new language. The intercultural potential of stories, bringing in lots of different cultures and diversity from within a culture through story and drama. So we can say stories open the windows of the mind and they bring new elements into our classrooms that can then be further explored through drama. Springboard to skills. So a multi-skills approach, an integrated skills approach. So if we're using recordings of read alouds, we have listening material there, but we also have viewing material to develop visual literacy. The children then acting out the stories using the dialogue, great for speaking skills practice. Children then can rewrite the ending of a story and then act that out. We have writing practice going on there. And they can also display their new endings virtually or as a gallery walk maybe in the classroom. And then we have reading going on there. So and also all of these 21st century skills. We've mentioned intercultural learning, critical thinking, divergent thinking, creativity. So they're all coming in there. Sharing story and unpacking and exploring and experimenting with story through drama really builds that classroom community. As we said before, they're social and communal, and they help children feel part. We're acting out together. We are being creative together. We're not being shy. We're really trying to take risks with our English. Then we feel more part of that learning community. And the last point, very importantly, is they have this affective appeal. They foster joy. They bring warmth. They bring a sense of lightness while still exploring deep, significant areas. So this joy, this uplifting spirit that story and drama can bring is so needed in this particularly challenging period that the world is facing. So lots and lots of reasons for using story and for using drama there. Okay. Now, to give you some practical examples, I'm drawing on a superb website full of freely downloadable resources, pedagogical principles, and inspiration. So this is the PEPELT website, and PEPELT stands for Picture Books in European Primary English Language Teaching. And it's one of my most favorite resources for children's picture books for use in primary ELT. And during these various lockdown periods, two of the PEPELT team, Gail Ellis and Tasha Gruenbaum, have developed mini e-lessons. So particularly for teaching children remotely, teaching online. And they include these recordings of the picture book creators sharing their stories. So reading aloud their stories. And there you see some examples of the picture books there. I've chosen four, so I want to share four with you today, and I've chosen them particularly for their dramatic potential. linked to the PEPFL team and the work of PEPFL team, we see this framework, this lesson framework for using story in primary English language teaching. And I want to draw on certain elements of the framework in particular. The yellow one there, add your voice, and also the blue one, share your work. Now, through adding children's voices, enabling them to creatively personalize around these stories and then share their creative outcomes is a superb way of giving voice and choice to children, these two crucial elements. And that's, I'll be giving lots of examples today of how we can do that. Okay, so personalization, so important, and drama is a great vehicle for children to add their own identity, their own feelings, their own emotions onto the topic through the story, and then acted out through drama. The read alouds then, great for developing both language, but also listening skills, viewing skills, and also focusing on the content in a way that captures their curiosity and interest, because the picture book creators are bringing in new voices to the classroom, particularly useful for online lessons. So it's not only the teacher reading aloud and sharing the story. And then giving children a reason to engage, a reason to do this skills work, this creative work, drama, and having a sense of pride and rehearsal. These are all skills, rehearsing, polishing, improving, that are part of being a good language learner. And so drama gives a child-friendly and a meaningful framework for doing that. So I'm drawing on elements of the PEPFL framework to give voice and choice. And I've said there to amplify voice, giving children more voice, more input into what they do with the activities in lessons by giving them choices around drama and drama techniques. Okay, so that's giving you my principles and my sources of inspiration. Now let's make this concrete and let's make this practical. And are you ready to get dramatic? I think we need a bit of the drama today. Okay, so this is one of the books I've chosen. I am a tiger. And this is by the author Carl Newson and the illustrator Ross Collins. They are the creators of I Am a Tiger. And the person saying I am a tiger is the mouse that you can see on the front cover. It's a very humorous story where the mouse is convinced that they are a tiger, and the other animals won't accept that, can't possibly believe that. This is a wonderful story using drama to give children practice of sentence stress and intonation in a child-friendly and engaging way. Because a lot of teachers say to me, oh, drilling, so boring. And I say, yes, it is, if you're saying repeat after me in a robotic manner. But if you're using physical affective drills linked to a story dialogue, it really gives children a motivating reason to work on their sentence stress and their intonation. And there is a very engaging refrain here linked to the noise, the sound a tiger makes, the grrr. So physical drills are a great way to use dialogue from a picture book and then bring it alive by having the children act out using that dialogue. But we do need to build their confidence. It's not enough just to go from that dialogue and then straight into acting out. And this is where physical drills are so useful. One of my favorite physical drills is the crocodile mouth. So when the sentence stress goes up, particularly linked to attitudinal intonation, the crocodile mouth opens. You can also do a stand up, sit down drill. You can do a raise your hands in the air, toes go up, or crouching down. So you can experiment with this depending on the age of the children, depending on what they enjoy. I particularly, the children that I've worked with, really enjoyed the crocodile mouth. So This would be, I am a tiger, says the mouse. And then the raccoon says, no, you're not. Tigers are much bigger and have a bit more grrr. And then mouse says, tigers can be small too. Grrr. So we have our big grrr and we have our small grrr. So you can see there that it's very playful, and it goes back to what Carol Reed was saying about the playful capacity of story and having the children act out the story in a playful manner. Okay, so the various mouse dialogues between the mouse and the raccoon, the mouse and the fox, and the hilarious part of this story is what the mouse says these different animals are. So for example, the fox is a balloon, the bird is a banana, and so on, or is it a lollipop? You'll have to listen to the story on YouTube and check. So this humour is great, and the visual literacy will help the children understand why mouse says you're a banana, you're a lollipop, you're a balloon, based on their physicality. So it's very engaging and very child friendly. And then they can act out in pairs and groups. You're the raccoon, you're the fox, you're the mouse. And so on. And so by doing those dialogues, you're giving the children scaffolding for them having their own voices around the story. And then we need to incorporate that element of choice, that all important element. So for example, the children could brainstorm on their own in pairs, in groups, three more animals, and also creatively and creative ideas and lexical stretching, building in that challenge and that creative challenge, they could then think of three creative objects that these animals could be. For example, I'm a zebra. No, you're not. Zebras have black and white stripes, says mouse. You are a newspaper, for example. And then the children can think of other creative combinations for animals and everyday objects. And brainstorm their ideas, and then of course role play these creations between the mouse and the other animal. I'm this, no you're not, you're that. And very enjoyable and has a lot of affective appeal. Okay, my next story then is Bigu. This is Bigu the alien. You can see her there on the front cover by Alexis Deacon. And Bigu arrives on Earth in this story, and she doesn't speak a human language. So significant issues there. For example, refugee children arriving in a new country, not speaking the language, and the feelings and emotions that come with that, but dealt with in a very safe, child-friendly and heartwarming way. It also links to the children's own experiences, language learners not always being able to easily express themselves. So a scaffolded way in to give the children voice could be watching Alexis Deacon read aloud on YouTube and joining in with Alexis Deacon when he creatively uses Bigu's alien language. Very engaging for children to notice the language rhythm, the patterns, the sounds, and join in with that language. Then, also a language-focused activity, the children could translate Bigu's language into their own languages, into English, and then role-play. Bigu arriving. So how does she feel when her ears are down? How does she feel when her ears are up? What's she saying? How is the sound of her voice, the intonation and the sentence stress, reflecting her feelings? So another creative way to give children voice when they act out Bigu's language. Now, building in the element of choice, we could use a guided visualization where the children have to imagine they are going to go to a new planet and they don't speak the alien language on that planet. How are they going to communicate? A nice drama technique as a way into this is a guided visualization. The children close their eyes and you talk them through the sights in their mind's eye. So imagine you land on the new planet. You open the spaceship door. What can you see? What do you hear? What can you smell? Who is there on the new planet? Open your eyes, tell your partner, tell your group, draw the new planet, describe the new planet, write about the new planet, so that integrated skills approach through the drama techniques of a guided visualization linked to the story. And then we can take it further through drama, and we can have the children role playing these alien meetings on the new planet. So it gives us a child-friendly context for expressing feelings and putting themselves in the shoes of a new arrival, very significant for these times and also very child-friendly. The next picture book then is by Ed Vare, and this is Max the Brave. And you can see on the front cover, there's Max the kitten with his cape, his superhero cape, which is very significant for later. Now, Max is a mouse catcher. Problem in this story is Max doesn't know what a mouse is. So he goes asking all of the other animals, "Are you a mouse?" An elephant says, "Oh, I'm not a mouse, I'm an elephant." Fish says, "I'm not a mouse, I'm fish." So doing those voices is very engaging for children and provides scaffolding for them to join in the story. So using the story to retell and have the children do the different animal voices first of all, and then using this book cover for the children to use drama techniques to recreate that pose. So there you see Max in his superhero pose. The children could use some props for this to inspire them and make capes. For example, an old shower curtain or a beach towel, or I just happen to have what I call my magic carpet for storytelling. So on comes the superhero cape. And then the superhero pose. So on comes the cape, and then how are we going to stand? And then the children use the lines from the story. For example, "I'm Max the Brave, and I'm going to catch you." And then the children can make up their own superhero lines and poses. So creative use then of the picture book covers, linking the visual, the creative, and the lines from the story. A creative idea would be for the children then to create a new friend for Max. And again, this could be through drawing, it could be through describing. And what would their quality be, their special quality? Max is brave. What other adjectives could they think of for other characters for Max? And then a creative drama idea would be for these two friends to go to a party. And this could be, for example, a pizza party, and they do their poses when they introduce themselves and tell the people they meet at the party, the other characters, what their special quality is. Okay, the last one today then, also by Ed Vare, and this is How to Be a Lion. Now, is there only one way to be a lion, or are there many? Are all lions fierce? So again, significant issues around convention and perhaps not conforming to convention. Now, there's a lot of onomatopoeia in this story, such as crunch, crunch, chomp. So the sounds of crunching, great for crocodile mouth drills again. Okay, now the other lions expect Leonard, this is the name of this character, Leonard the Lion, to be fierce. But actually, Leonard the Lion is a daydreamer and a poet. And so they can join in the story, so bringing that scaffolding for voice by repeating those frames, crunch, crunch, chomp, 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 crunch, etc. And then there's a part of the story where Leonard introduces himself to a new friend. The new friend's name is Marianne. And Marianne is a duck. And the other lions say, "A duck, bad luck, that duck, crunch, crunch, jump." But actually, very sophisticated Leonard, very politely introduces himself, "Hello, I'm Leonard." And Marianne says, "Hello, I'm Marianne." And as luck would have it, Marianne is a poet duck. So what a fabulous friendship there then. Leonard, the lion who loves poetry, and Marianne, the poet duck. And so a little bit of creative and critical thinking for the children to do in pairs and groups. Is there only way, one way, to be a lion, or are there many? A great way to take drama even further, so using the story, using drama, is to bring in authentic songs, to really lift the story off the page, take it beyond the book and into another but related context. And children could write their own verses for these songs. They could change the character in the song. They could change some of the lyrics. And then they could make up their own actions and act out the song. So we're going to demonstrate this with a song about a lion. I wonder if you can guess what this song might be. We're not going to sing, actually. We're going to do the actions. And in true dramatic fashion, we're going to lip sync. So I'd like you to join in this song, find your dramatic space in your classroom, in your living room, wherever you might be. And are you ready to be brave, to be bold, and to lip sync? Okay, have you guessed the song yet? There you go. All right. Ready? Ready? So you can see there the creative potential, what the children could do then to act out this song, change elements of it, etc. So my final message for you today then is use story. Use drama techniques, combine them creatively to give children lots of choice in your primary English classes, and very importantly, lots of voice. So very best of luck experimenting with story and drama in your English lessons online and face to face. Here are some useful references for you. Please check out the PEPELT website. Lots of free mini e-lessons, lots of creative and dramatic inspiration for those story lessons there. And finally, then, I'd like to say a huge thank you to everyone for attending today. Enjoy the rest of the Global Schools Festival for the rest of the day and tomorrow. You can download your certificate from that link. Stay safe, teach well, and thank you again. Bye-bye.